Hello to everybody. Welcome to this talk about finite MTL chains. First of all, I would like to thank the organizers, Chiro, Samuel and Marcelo for inviting me to this conference. And I know they did a lot of efforts just to have me there, but unfortunately I couldn't go there. It's a pity. Let's see whether in the near future I'm able to visit Brazil. I hope so. And I also want to thank them for allowing me to record the talk. I have to confess, it's the first time I finished the slides of a talk, I think around 6 hours earlier. So let's see the talk. So the talk is about finite MTL chains. So MTL stands for monoidal T-norm logics. And in the first slide, I will show you the framework that we have here for those people who are more or less familiar. In the next slide, don't worry, you will see the same framework for those people who are not familiar with these logics. So we have a logic, a propositional logic, who is using this language that we have here. I guess you can see the cursor here of the mouse. So we have the lattice operations, two constants, the bottom and the maximum, but the maximum is also the integral element of the monoidal operation, that is denoted by the dot. And for the integral element, I am using the E symbol. And then we have some residuation. That's the implication, is the residuation of the monoidal. That's what I mean. And then there are some familiar logics here, MTL, BL, involutive MTL, and involutive BL, that usually it's called MB algebras. And in this setting, we have, in the framework of substructural logics, you have that you are with exchange and weakening, full lambda with exchange and weakening, and then you add the prelinearity and some other properties. I just want to emphasize that I am going to talk about this MTL algebras. And the main distinction with BL, that it's a subvariety, is this axiom that you have here, that's the divisibility axiom. And let me point out that you really need the implication to write it down. You cannot write down this axiom without the implication. Okay, so this is the language that is usually used for talking about these logics. And what I'm going to do in the talk is getting rid of the implication. So I will consider a different language. It's the lattice operations plus the monoidal. So I will call this the lattice monoid language. And we don't have the implication here, but we don't have neither the negation that is usually defined as implies implication zero. So it's really a different language. But the important thing is that completely determines the other ones, because the situation is uniquely determined from the monoidal operation. So if I want to understand the algebras in the full language up to isomorphism, it's enough to understand the ones in the small language. And this is the algebras I'm going to focus. So these are the lattice redox of the MTL chains. And for those who are not familiar with the literature of these substructural logics, this is the definition of the things I am going to focus on. So we are going to have binary operations which satisfy these four properties. So we have a total partial order, a linear partial order with minimum and maximum. The maximum is also the neutral element of an associative operation, that's the dot operation. And this dot operation satisfies, besides associativity, two more properties. It's commutative, abelian, and moreover, it's monotone in each one of the components. Okay. So this is the structures I want to focus on. So they are really simple structures from a mathematical point of view. So it's just these things. We have the finite set that we can assume it's 0, 1, 2, and so on until n. And then we have a monoidal operation here. So for instance, two cases of these things are these ones. It's really easy to check that this is abelian, both tables. It's also clear that the number 4 is a neutral element of this operation, if you look here, and also on the other table. And it's also clear that each one of the rows is increasing. The only property that is not trivial to check is associativity. And this is in general what is a headache, to recognize which of these tables are associative and which are not. Okay. For sure, I am assuming here that the linear order, the total order, is the obvious one. So I mean, 0 is below 1, 1 below 2, 2 below 3, and so on. Okay. So let me say some more terminology that appears here. A standard, in general, in this setting, is used just to mean that the lattice reduct is the unit real interval. An interesting point is that both MTL and BL are complete with respect to the, this kind of algebra, so the algebras with the unit real interval as universe. Moreover, in the case of BL, you have completeness with respect to the those operations, monoidal operations, T-norms, that are continuous in the topological setting of the unit real interval. And indeed, it's well known which are exactly all these T-norms operations. They are exactly Gödel, which is the infimum, product, which is the product of real numbers, Lucas-Jegis, which is computed in this way, and then you have some combinatorial combination of them. That's a well-known operation called ordinal sums. But these are all continuous T-norms. And then for MTL, you have also another kind of completeness, but this time is for those monoidal operations, T-norms, that are less continuous. And here the samples are much more wild. Some easy sample is the nilpotent minimum that is defined in this way, but they are really wild. And indeed, this is one of the big differences between MTL and MBL. We have a really good understanding of what is going on with BL, but not at all about what is going on with MTL. And this is somehow the focus of my talk. I would like to understand better which are the MTL algebras, the MTL chains. Okay. So one of the reasons why it's much more easier to understand BL is because it's really, we really know them up to isomorphism. So if I look up to all the BL chains of cardinal 5, I know there are exactly 8 of them. And indeed, in all these cases, we know how to describe them. They are ordinal sums of certain MB chains. So we really know all of them, and we know how to describe them. If we consider the involutive BL ones, so the MB ones, the things are much more easier. There is only one in each one of these cases. On the other hand, if we consider MTL, so I take away the divisibility condition, axiom, things are much more wilder. Indeed, this is the sequence that is increasing really quickly. And below you can find the entrance in the online integral sequence encyclopedia. If you are curious, you can go there and check this. But you have quite a lot of them. But what is interesting to point out is that if you just focus on the involutive ones, you still have quite a lot of them, but the numbers are much more narrow. So it seems much more possible somehow to understand these involutive ones. And indeed, one of the things that we will see later is that in some sense this will be enough to understand these involutive ones in order to understand all the others. Okay, so let me say which is the main problem I want to focus. Is there some lattice monoid equation that is valid in all BL algebras but fails in some MTL algebra? In order to answer this, I need to understand what are the MTL chains. So which are these strange tables fulfilling all the previous properties, associativity and so on. And this is in general is very embarrassing because it's not clear. For instance, focusing these questions, we have some particular equation here. So I'm not writing the symbols here, but it's the dot symbol. So it's the monoidal operation, that the one that applies between the variables. So suppose I am wondering whether this equation is valid in all MTL chains. It's really hard to answer this because one tried to use a computer in order to enumerate all the tables satisfying the properties, but unfortunately you don't get an answer. I mean, computer gets stuck somehow. I mean, you can use proof checkers and after some days you don't get an answer. And the point is that it's really hard to recognize which are MTL algebras. And later I will try to provide you some combinatorial approach to describe them. And in this sense, this approach will allow to answer this question. This is somehow embarrassing in the sense that it's very easy to state the question, but it's not clear at all how to answer. So let me come back again to the main problem that I have written in the upper part. And why I think this is interesting? I think this is interesting because even without knowing in principle, suppose the answer, each one of the possibilities has some interest. In case that the answer is no, that you cannot distinguish MTL from BL, this would provide a representation theorem for all MTL algebras using the famous Tarski representation using homomorphic images, subalgebras, and direct products of the generators of the variety. On the other hand, in the case that the answer is yes, that you can distinguish them, that indeed this is what will happen and we will see later, then we need to understand better what's going on here, because we need to be able to build some strange finite MTL algebras where this equation somehow fails. Okay, so let me say the two important statements that I want to advertise in this talk. These are the concerning the lattice monoid language. So the full language getting away the implication. So the first remark is that I'm not interested in the fragment. I am really interested in the full language. But a better understanding of this fragment is also providing a better understanding of the full language. And I hope you will see what I mean at the end of the talk with the examples I will show you later. And the other important remark is that in some cases it's much more easier to work with this fragment, the lattice monoid fragment, than with the full language. This in principle could seem surprising, because in this fragment we don't have a good understanding of congruences and things like that. But I also hope that at the end of the talk you will see why I do this claim now. Okay, so let me give you a very briefly idea about the pros and the cons between considering the full language of the lattice monoid fragment. If we have the full language, a pro is that we understand congruences. They are completely characterized by the class of the neutral element, of the E element. And the con somehow is that the free algebra is really difficult. For the BL case, we still have some description of the finally generated free BL algebras, but this is absolutely out of scope in the MTL case. On the other hand, for the lattice monoid case, a pro is that the congruences are really difficult. They are really wild. And a pro in this case is that the free abelian monoid is easy. So it's just the natural numbers and the direct sum of natural numbers of the monoid with addition, additive monoid of the natural numbers. So this is somehow the balance between considering the full language and the other language. Okay, so the first remark, if we just consider the small language, so the lattice monoid language, as I have told you, it's really difficult to understand the congruences. But what is surprising is we can understand which are the subdirectly reducible elements, so some particular kind of congruences. And these are exactly the ones that satisfy these three properties. They must be changed, they must have a penultimate element, a coatom, and they must be involutive. Okay. I am cheating you somehow here because I cannot talk about the involutive property, because the involutive property, as you see, is written using the negation, and I don't have the negation in this language. Okay, so what do I mean when I say involutive in this context, in the context where I don't have negation in the language? The crucial point is to do a restatement of this condition that you have here for the involutive negation. This condition can be rewritten in this way. And this again, using the residuation, can be rewritten in this way. Two elements have the same negation element when they have the same, this property holds for all the element sets. And this property, if you check, is completely written in the lattice monoid fragment. So this is the property that I am defining to be involutive. It's not exactly the same property that in the bigger language, but in the case of, in the finite case, or in the case where you have the residuation, it's exactly the same property. And indeed, you can also have some other ways to write the same condition. They are equivalent. Okay. So what is interesting is that the subdirectly reducible pieces are the involutive ones. So in other words, if a lattice monoid equation fails in some MTL algebra, it has to fail in some involutive ones. So we only need to focus on the involutive ones. Okay. So let's now move to focus on the involutive ones. There are really nice things about involutive ones. The first thing is that you indeed have the full language, because once you have involutive, using the monoidal operation, you can recover the full residuation in this way. And another thing is that you have a duality in the obvious way. You could use, instead of the of a monoidal operation that is contractive, the dot symbol, you could use one that is expansive and use an addition symbol. And the duality works in this way. You interchange dot and plus, meet and join, the order, and the bottom and the neutral element. So for instance, in the particular case of the question I was saying before that it's embarrassing to answer whether it's valid or not, the fact that this equation is valid in all involutive MTL algebras is exactly equivalent to saying this other one is involutive. So it's just replacing the dot with additions, the meets with joins, and then reversing the order. So somehow this is just the question that I need to check in all involutive ones in order to see whether this is a statement, this equation is true in all involutive ones or not. Okay, so in order to check this, somehow the obvious way is just to consider all involutive algebras of cardinal 5, then cardinal 6, and so on, check whether this is true or not. And for instance, if I do so with cardinal 5, this is exactly the algebras that I have. Okay, and if I use the additive notation, these are the other ones. I don't care which are them. The point is that, except if I am using a computer, it seems really annoying to find them. And another interesting point is that it's very easy to recognize in the tables when a table is involutive. It's just meaning that the upper diagonal is full with zeros. And there are no zeros in below the diagonal. This is exactly equivalent to being involutive. Here you have the ones of cardinal 5. Here you have the ones of cardinal 6. But I mean, it's just using a computer to find them. But the point is that we don't have a good understanding of them, except for the fact that the computer can tell us which are them. Here I have written down the 12 ones that appear with cardinal 7. But I mean, okay. So, and if you check with these ones, it seems that you are not getting a contrasample of the previous equation. So it seems you need a more sophisticated army to deal with this problem. Okay, and this is what I am going to do now. So let me start focusing just with the two generated involutive MTL chains. So when I say two generated, I mean from the point of view of the lattice monoid reduct. So I don't allow to use the negation, and I don't allow to use the implication. This is important because, for instance, Chang algebra, it's an involutive BL algebra, and it is an MB algebra. It's well known that it's one generated if you allow the implication, if you allow the negation. But if you go to the lattice monoid reduct, then it's not finally generated. You really need an infinite number of things. So these things are get away from here. So suppose I want to describe the two generated involutive ones. And this is what I am going to do. I will consider a grid given by the natural numbers. And I'm going to focus in the additive monoid that I have here. And I am going to put some red tokens in different display configurations. So for instance, in this picture, you have 8 different display configurations. For instance, in this picture, we have 8 different token configurations. In some cases, we will see that we don't get an involutive MTL chain associated with the configuration, for instance, in the third case here. And in some other case, what we will get associated with these token configurations will be involutive MTL chains. So in which cases do we obtain involutive ones? For that purpose, I am going to introduce the definition of admissible token configuration. And this is the definition. An admissible token configuration must have the following properties. First of all, it has to be an anti-chain. And then once you have the anti-chains, you can consider the monoidal that it generates, and that I am going to be calling this monoidal ideal I. So in other parts, it's just the all the elements that are above of the anti-chains of the tokens that I have put. It will be more clear this later in the pictures that I will show you. And the second condition is the following one. When I subtract things to the ideal, and I do it in all possible ways, what I get is a total order. So for instance, I am subtracting 1 to the left and 1 down, or 2 to the left and 2 down, or 3 to the left and 2 down, and things like that. This is what I am doing to the full block I. I'm claiming that this moving of the blocks is a total order. This condition can be rewritten in the following way, but this is just writing the definition of being a total order. And this can also be rewritten in this other way. If you write down the things, this is exactly what it means. And then finally, you can even find another way to write the same, but this time just using the minimal elements of the ideal. And the advantage here is that the minimal elements are a finite set. So this last condition can be checked in a computer, while the other ones in principle are not checkable. Okay, so whenever these two things happen, I will say that I have an admissible configuration, or what I will be calling a communication ideal. Okay, I will call this communication ideal because the second condition is very close to what in sequence calculus are called communication rules. Okay, so let me show you with examples which is the IMTL algebra associated with some of these token configurations. Let's consider the 8 examples that I was showing you in the previous, in some picture before. So this is the first example. So this is the token that I have, only one token in the configuration. Okay, if I consider the ideal, is this blue region. Now I consider all possible ways to move this blue region, this ideal, to the left and downwards. In this case, these are the only two ways. It's the same initial ideal, or just moving the ideal 1 to the left. If I move it 2 to the left, I get the same than 1 to the left. So these are all possible ways to move the ideal and then cutting with the natural numbers. So I consider now these blue regions and I check whether they are a total order. In this case, they are. One is included in the other. So this is the reason why I'm getting an involutive one. And indeed, from the token configuration, I can also compute the table of the monoidal operation. But I will show you how this table is computed later in another more interesting example. Another case. And okay, in this case, what I get is the two-element Boolean algebra. Suppose I start with this other token configuration. Then I consider the monomial ideal that it generates. It's this blue region. And now I consider all possible ways to move this block to leftwards and downwards. In this case, this is the only possible way. It's this new region can be obtained in either moving 1 to the left or moving 1 down. So again, the blue regions form a total order in this case. And again, I can compute a truth table, and in this case I get the same algebra than before, the two-element Boolean algebra. Another possibility, suppose I start with this token. Now I consider the ideal that it generates, so it's this blue region. And now I consider all possible ways to move this downwards and leftwards. And these are the four possible ways I get. In this case, you can see that this is not a total order, because, I mean, if I put names here, the region corresponding to the number 1 and the region corresponding to the number 2, they are not comparable. So in this case, this is the reason why I'm not getting an involutive MTL chains, and indeed, this is the reason why this is not an admissible configuration, so it's not a communication ideal, this display of the tokens. So let's consider some other cases. Suppose I start with this. I consider the ideal is this thing, and now I consider all possible ways to move it down. And these are the only ways. And then in this case, I have a total order. So then I will get an involutive MTL chain, and I am able to compute the table. In this case, this is a table. Let us wait some minutes. I mean, in two more slides, I will tell you how to compute the table. But the elements of the table, I guess that now are pretty clear. It's just the initial ideal and the blocks correspond to moving downwards and leftwards. Okay, and I can do the same, for instance, with this other example. If I start here, this is the ideal, and now I consider possible ways to move. This is what I get. And since this is, again, a total order, we also get an involutive MTL chain. And if I compute the table with the recipe I will give you later, this is the one I get. So in this case, it's the four element MB chain again. And with another example of the 8 ones that I considered before, I have this. So if I start with these tokens and I take the ideal generator, is this one, this blue region. If I consider now this, possible ways. This is exactly the four elements that I get, and they form a total order. So for instance, the element 2 can be obtained doing the following thing. It's just moving the initial ideal one downwards. Okay, so now let's look at this table, how we can compute the table of the monoidal operation. If I want to apply two monoidal operation with two, this is what I have to do. Remember that two, the element two here, corresponds to moving the initial ideal one downwards. So in order to combine two with two, I need to do this two times. So I have to move it one downwards and then one downwards again. And then if you do this and you check it, you see that this is an important element. So two cooperated with two is the same element than two. And you can do the same to compute all the elements in the truth table. So let's consider another example. So let's suppose I have this token configuration. This is the ideal I have here. And now I consider all possible ways to move it downwards and leftwards. And this is exactly what I get. And now if you check the blue regions, you can see that this is a total order. All of them are comparable. So again, you can put numbers here, and now you can compute the things that you have there. So this is a very interesting case. So let's suppose you consider the element 4 here. If you look at the element 4, I guess you see that this is exactly considering the initial ideal and moving one downwards. This is what corresponds to element 4. So if I apply the monoidal operation of element 4 with the same element, I have to do this operation moving one downwards twice. In other words, when I apply number 4 with number 4 in the monoidal operation, I get 2, because this thing is exactly taking the element 4 and moving it one downwards. This is exactly the same region. So I guess now that you see how to compute the monoidal operation table from these blocks that we have here. It's just to concatenate the number of movements that you have done leftwards and downwards. This is exactly what you need to do. Okay, and finally, this is the last example in the previous picture, but I mean, I will skip it. Okay, so what is interesting are the following facts. Every algebra associated with a communication ideal in the plane is a finite involutive one. Indeed, it's a finite involutive two-generated one. And indeed, all involutive MTL chains that are two-generated can be obtained in this way. They are exactly all of them. Now, if you generalize this thing from two dimensions to a finite number of dimensions, the same is still true. So in particular, all finally generated, all the four generated involutive MTL chains come from doing the same kind of construction, but with four dimensions now, instead of two dimensions. But the idea is exactly the same one, exactly the same one. Even in the infinite case, you can do something very similar if you use the free monoid. Okay, so now the big question is whether we can recognize when some token displayed, some token configuration is a communication ideal or not. And here it's very handy to use some notions of algebraic geometry. And the point is to use what is called in algebraic geometry monomial orderings. But I'm going to present them in another setting. Usually they are presented using monomials, so I mean certain kind of polynomials, but here I'm just going to talk about them using the additive monoid of the natural numbers. They are exactly the total orders that are compatible with this monoidal, with this monoid. Okay, and there are ones that are very interesting ones that are exactly the admissible ones, are all those monomial orderings that also satisfy the property that all elements are above zero, so all elements are above are positive. These are the admissible ones, and this is exactly the same than claiming that every non-empty subset has an infimum. So in particular, in admissible monomial orderings, all upsets are principal upsets. And the point is that these admissible monomial orderings and these monomial orderings have been completely characterized, and we can use this stuff in order to produce particular cases of this, and they have really nice geometrical characterizations. I'm not going to go into the details of this, but the point is that And these monomial orderings provide a very easy example to obtain communication ideals, because all upsets of admissible monomial orderings are indeed communication ideals. And this is a very easy way to obtain communication ideals. Another very easy way to obtain communication ideals is the anti-image under a monoid homomorphism of some ideal satisfying the properties. But essentially, these are the only two ways I know to obtain communication ideals. It's worth saying here that the geometric interpretation that you have for these monomial admissible orderings provides a very easy way to recognize immediately from the picture whether this display of token configurations, whether they are admissible or not. I'm not gonna go into the details, but just looking at the geometrical characteristics, you can really recognize this directly without going into so much details about the definition of communication ideal. Okay, but I skip this part. So let's come again to the original question. Is this equation valid in BL and false in some MTL? Okay, so first of all, let me rewrite the question in some way that shows you that there are two kinds of symmetries here. One corresponds, one is indicated in this alternative presentation using the same letters, X, Y, and Z. And the other symmetry is represented using the same superscript symbol. Okay, so the first point is that this equation is valid in all BL algebras. I know another theoretical argument, but I have to confess that right now I don't know how to prove this using a syntactic approach, in other words, using the divisibility condition that appears in the axiomatization of BL. I guess that the proof has to be really long. And another thing is that this equation fails in some MTL algebra. And how can we show this? The point is that we can give an explicit counterexample, and this is what I did. This is exactly the monoidal operation that I found that can be used to show that it is a counterexample. Okay, you can use the table here, and if you have the slides, you can copy this and put it to some Python script, and then you can use the table just to compute things. So this is the reason why I have written the table in this way, because you can use directly in a computer in case you are interested. So for sure, the part here is absolutely not trivial, is to recognize that this is an associative operation. Okay, but the important question is, how did I get to this table? Okay, and let me try to answer this. In order to answer this, let me first of all introduce some definition. I will say that an algebra is exotic when there is some lattice monoid equation that distinguish BL from this algebra. And I will say that the dimension of such an algebra is the number of generators in the lattice monoid part. Okay, so in particular, the previous statement can be rewritten as saying that the previous algebra, the one in the previous slide, is an exotic algebra of dimension 9. Okay, the dimension somehow is controlling the number of symbols that you have in the equation that is distinguishing BL from MTL. And if you are curious, just to check in the previous example, the counterexample, this is exactly the counterexample, and somehow up to symmetry is the only counterexample. Okay, and if you compute the implication, you get this, and if you compute the addition, you get this. So I have just included them here just in case you want to use this in some Python script. Okay, so let me rewrite the initial question. We wanted to falsify this equation in some involutive MTL chain. In other words, we need to find some communication idea where these things happen. And this is exactly what I have done in order to build the previous algebra. Okay, how did I build the ideal? I'm not gonna give a lot of details, but somehow I used the two trivial ways I told you before. So anti-image of a monoid homomorphism and upsets of admissible monomial orderings. And using this kind of construction, I obtained a communication ideal. But this communication ideal was not fulfilling the property. But then I added some elements to the ideal, and then I obtained a new set, and I was able to prove by hand that this was also a communication ideal. So this small perturbation is the one that I used. And indeed, this is what I did by hand, and then at some point I decided to compute the table corresponding to this, and this is when I obtained the table that I showed you before. But the idea was using this small perturbation method in the trivial ways to obtaining communication ideals. Okay, so just to finish the talk and to make a summary, so the conclusions that I hope I have been able to transmit here are: a better understanding of the lattice monoid fragment will help us to understand the full language. The monoidal operation in MTL chains can be recovered from involutive ones, because these are the subdirectly reducible pieces in this fragment. Okay, I recognize this is not really useful because congruences in this fragment are really wide, but anyway, you have some way to recover them. Involutive MTL chains correspond to communication ideals. Upsets of monomial orderings are an easy way to obtain a communication ideals, but they are not all communication ideals. But nevertheless, let me say here that in dimension 2, they are exactly the same ones. And a small perturbation method has been used to obtain this quite pathological example of a communication ideal. But what other kind of methods can we use to build exotic IMTL chains? This is a very interesting question, in my opinion. And just to finish, so let me say that this research, somehow I have the feeling that focus in the following more general program. I think we really need to bring ideas from algebraic geometry to this setting. This has been done before, for instance, in the case of MB algebras. And I guess that something can be also done in this more general setting of MTL. I like to think in the following way. In the MB case, you only worry about one monomial ordering, the lexicographic ordering. While in the MTL case, you need to worry about all monomial orderings, and perhaps even about something else, about all communication ideals. So, thank you for listening.